scoreboard. Hopefully you read that on the thing. Who here has seen the TV show Steampunked? Okay, I was that judge. I have to tell people that. I'm like, do I look that different? Oh, yes, I do, because that, when I was in the show, that's an hour and a half hair makeup every day. This is what you get when you're at a convention. This is all you get. I don't get any better. It's not going to happen. I had a great time on the show. People always ask me, did you enjoy the show? I was a judge, so I had a great time. I got paid no matter what. I was worried about whether I could do better than the other people there, so I had a wonderful time on the show. The contestants, not so much. They had kind of a miserable time. They were sequestered. They were not allowed to talk to each other when they weren't on camera. but one of the things I kind of got known for is I use laser cutters and 3D printers and all that type of stuff to all my costumes and cosplay and to produce product for my show. But also when I'm working with, I do a lot of props and stuff for television. Any Castle fans watch the TV show Castle? Did you see the steampunk episode? I made that armor that Nathan Fillion was wearing. If you look closely at that episode, you'll see this guy, a British officer out of there, walking around looking really confused. That's me. they said, would you like to be, an extra? And I'm like, hell yes! You're going to fly me out all the way from Pennsylvania? They said, oh, you're not local. That's right. We don't fly extras. And I'm like, oh, they said, hold on a second. The guy calls the boss. You're now a consultant. We fly consultants. And like, hey, fly me. And that's how I ended up there. I'm trying to make sure I pull up the right things and I don't completely freak out anyone that I go, oh, no. And I'll tell you why. My girlfriend is a model, and she does modeling for things like Penthouse. So occasionally I'm like, nude picture!
Oh, God.
Children and nude pictures, yes. Everyone here is mostly adultish, right? And all that type of stuff. Close enough, man. Almost. So I'm trying to pull up some pictures because I found out at the last minute that they had audio video. So that was there. Panels, stuff, graphics. I don't want to do that. Panels and stuff. There. Where was that? That's the castle arm. That right there. And what made this possible, because look at all that filigree work and all that stuff, is I took the leather and I laser cut it. Nowadays that sounds like a pretty big deal, I have a laser cut. Let's look at the machine for about 15 years ago. I'm like, hey, my friend has a laser. I wonder if it'll cut leather. And it did. And we started a fire.
Amazing.
It was horrible because we thought, hey, the beam's invisible. Let's take this stuff called cloud in the can and spray it under it and make it. Had a couple of these. So we put it out and we started tweaking how to do it. And we looked around and the only place they were cutting with a laser was they were cutting soles for shoes. The company cutting soles for shoes. And I thought, well, let's tweak it a little bit. And then we started doing, you can turn the laser down, so only engraves, and you can do things like that. That's all clip art dumped into Corel Draw. Anyone know what Corel Draw is? You know, it's kind of like Illustrator's kind of messed up brother. He didn't get enough nutrients in the living room, and I got to like Corel Draw. But it's cheap. Corel Draw is really cheap. That's what I like about it, because it's cheap. That's my favorite part. Actually, pull up Corel Draw. Where is it? The graphics. Like that. So, I was giving a lecture on William Morris.
Nobody knows.
He was a big Victorian artist. Lots of wallpapers and stuff were done by him. He also illustrated the Canterbury Tales. I'm giving this lecture, and I'm in my late 40s at the time, and I'm the youngest person there. And I didn't know that coming in. And I hand over my lecture notes on a hard drive, and it actually kind of pops up and it says lecture notes, and another file says quite possibly porn. Which wasn't, but it was just everything else on there. I needed to dump it somewhere. And I forgot that ever there, I was the youngest person there. They took it well. I'm lying. So this is CorelDRAW. And the reason I'm pulling this up, okay, where's this? I'm obsessed with that. What I'm going to do, what I'm showing you here, I tend to bounce around a lot when I talk about things, is I'm using this line art stuff to design, I'm making a Fallout Bethesda. Remember the other game Fallout? Yeah, a friend of mine works at Bethesda Games. I didn't know he worked at Bethesda Games until I told him I wanted to do a Vespa that was post-apocalyptic. Because it's a Vespa, I'm really. It's not even a big motor. He expected a big Harley or something. It's a Vespa. The engine's this big. I had actually walked around with the engine like this. With a wheel on it, I can still do that. So I'm starting to do this all this design work using CorelDRAW, pulling in elements from the motorcycles from the game to put on my Vespa. And he has a file. And I love this file. Where's that? He has that 3D file. So we're going to take this 3D file and we're going to cut this off. And this is from the original game point. So we are CADing in the Vespa and we're taking the bike they have there and we're making it so we can 3D print all the elements, all those elements you saw earlier, so that my bike is going to cosplay. Now I'm going to have a cosplay bike. Maybe I'll make it here next year. I wouldn't drive it here, but it's like 60 miles an hour top speed downhill in that tailwind. Without a costume. Because if I have a costume, that's 100 pounds of costume. But we're able to make these pieces. I'm very excited about the idea that from the game itself, we're taking the actual file from the game and now producing the parts to make a costume. I'm going to make a costume go with that. But back to the laser. anyone do leather work? Anyone do pounding on leather work? Pain in the ass, man. It's expensive. I know. I've been doing it for years. I did hand-tooled leather for years. Couldn't make a dime in it. I don't have a day job. I make costumes. And most of it is because I can use technology, the laser cutter, stuff like that. Now I have a laser cutter in my garage, as you do. No, you don't. They have maker spaces, things like that. You can also generate your file, generate your idea, send it to someone else, and they'll cut it for you. People like me who go, hey, my laser's not working today. And I have a list of people who have files that they want done. And I call them, and I go, hey, do you want me to cut that? Oh, you ran out of money? Gotta go buy it. Hey, oh, you want me to cut that? I start cutting their stuff when I'm not cutting my stuff. The laser has paid for itself many times over. But I've had it for like 15 years. And one of the cool things is, everyone, when you're making leather work and everything, you gotta punch all these holes. No, the laser actually laser out every hole. This right there, when you're cutting, if you're trying to cut that by hand, it just would never happen. You can't get that shape. Well, you could, but you would never live through the process. After a while, you're like, it'd take a long time. But that makes it so I can produce this and make it, we'll call it a film. This is about a $500 piece. And I've got a 6-month waiting list. It sounds like a lot until you try to do something like this by hand. Yes?
How long did it take to fabricate that from the game?
It took 20 years to be as fast as I am. That's the fun part. The actual fabrication, I did this in an afternoon. But the CAD work and getting this corset, perfecting that design so that it doesn't cut in, so it does work, and so that it's expandable. We can make the same size. We make our samples this size. I have people say, why do you make your samples so small? Leather's expensive. That's why. And scaling. A lot of people, all the costume people, you've worked with patterns, right? Once you digitize the pattern, you will now have a new religion. Because my God, it's so much easier to do all of this, say, adventure girl, that's so much fun. Corsets. Regular corsets. Rubber corsets. I don't know. Where's a good corset? I want a cool corset. that is our corset pattern right there. So, this is neat. It says 23. See, it says 23 on it. So I take that and I copy it up here. Okay. So, I need to make a 28-inch corset. Instead. Here's what I do.
This is my 28-inch corset. Let's see what it is. Unlocked, yes.
I keep thinking you guys can see this.
And it can't.
So I get a, like this, 28 divided by 23 equals 1.217. So 1.22. I take that and I go in the y direction. I go like this. 122%. It now fits someone with a 28-inch waist instead of 23-inch waist. It's that simple. Then I go and I change those. The holes become oblong. And I go in and I change those. But it was that quick. Because people say, can you make it my size? And I go, yes. I don't go, well, I got to charge you more because I'm going to be making a new pattern. My pattern's instant. And there's little adjustments I'll make. Well, I would like the shoulder straps should stay the same. So I'll just move that little piece over. It's so much easier than taking your pattern and you got to scale it. That's generally it. It's much easier than doing that. And that's even if you don't use a laser cutter or anything, if you can use touch your patterns, like I said, you'll be going all crazy with them. One of my favorite things about the laser is I can do this part. See how that's all red and a different color? That's done with leather dye. Now, if you use leather dye, dyes get all over the place. They spread. It's like, how do you do that? I put Friskit film on it. Right, I laser etch all the artwork that's in the background. Then I put Friskit film over it. Then I cut Friskit film with the laser, peel off the red, and hit it with the red with airbrushed leather dye. And it makes this beautiful little thing with perfect lines around it. It's so much faster than going in with a dye pen, writing it in there and stuff like that. I'm all about cheating. Just ask my girlfriend. I don't need that. She's not here. One of the things that kills costuming, kills any project, is the frustration. You get to a certain point and you look at it, and it looks like a giant mountain to make this. We all have cool ideas, and then we go, but I don't know how to. And the technologies that are available now are so cool by comparison. I did cosplay back when they called it costuming. I didn't even have a cosplay. A friend of mine did a thing on the word cosplay and how it actually came about. An American guy actually said cosplay and was going to Japan, all this stuff. Look it up, it's kind of cool. But we used to call it recreation costuming. It was doing Nightcrawler from the X-Men. And now, I look at the costumes now, they're so much better because you have much better materials. I was using old t-shirt material to get all the colors and everything. I was an acrobat then, that was like 30, 40 pounds, I mean years ago. It was a long time ago. And I do the whole, all that type of stuff, and I have a tail like that. I had it rigged up so that there were two little bars here, and I clutched each butt cheek and tail. It worked really well. Some people get grabbing my tail, walking around, excuse me. Now, finally, somebody came up with cosplay is not consent. This was 30 years ago, and they were like, oh, cosplay? Here, let me grab your cosplay. Because you were not a person in their head. That's kind of a different character. It was a creepier time. It was. As a guy's mom was being chased around, going, stop groping this one. I was there. But I'm loving how it's made things simpler. It's made it easier for people who don't have the means to go buy sclera contacts. I mean, now you can buy contact lenses for $20 on Etsy or eBay or somewhere. I remember them being $300 for a contact. That's $300 in 1995 dollars, which is like $304. That's actually much more than that. Inflation's a lot better. bigger. But one of the other things I can do with my laser, and most of the lasers you're going to have access to, will not cut metals. Metals start at 200 watts and then go up. My laser that I, and I'm cutting pretty thick leather, is a 40 watt laser. I did some things to it so it cuts like a 90 watt laser because, you know, it's really cool when you start talking to laser guys because they start talking like their cars. Yeah, I got this thing. I got mine up to 80 watts. And I go, wow, dude, wow. It's the exhaust system. Yeah, it's actually, you know, look at that. Look at those pipes. And everyone thinks, what type of car do you have? And I'm like, I drive a minivan. Oh, we're talking about the laser. Yeah. And so you can overcrank them and stuff like that. But I can't cut metals with it. But I can design. I can cut a pattern. And I have a router, a following router. So a following router means that you put the pattern on there and it follows the pattern. Well, that's how I cut my metals. I cut acrylic on the laser, and then I use another thing to follow. And that's, and people go, you cut it so smooth. Like, that's how I do it. Here's another thing. Who uses craft foam? Here's a craft foam. So I took the cheapest material in the world, craft foam. And I decided to use the most expensive tool I can find. I used industrial cutting lasers for craft foam. And it was kind of awesome what happens. Because you can set the laser to cut. Now, when you do the craft foam stuff, one of the hard things is when you're doing a radius, you get that chunky look, you know what I mean? And you gotta either sand it out, and then you accidentally sand a little too hard, you got a little place in there, and you pretend that that's battle damage. Always make it look like you meant it. That's all it has to do. That's how art works. I meant to put that mark there. It makes it look good. The laser, perfect little lines and stuff. I made one of those, you know, battle bikinis? You know those things? I made a battle bikini with this girl in it, a model in it and everything. I made this thing in an afternoon. And we laser etch out divots, and then we put other pieces in there, laser cut pieces. So it looks like gold inlay. It looks much more metallic. I'm trying to think if I have internet access, I can't shoot it. And I think it's with that's right, it's with the porn star girl. That's not the porn star girl. But I don't think I can shoot it. I have to worry about these things. All this stuff. Cool. Yeah, this is for high tech. That's from, I wrote a book on how to make steampunk stuff. I do fantasy and all this other stuff, but steampunk got very popular, so I ended up with a lot of steampunk. That's all laser etched, too. You can take acrylic, that's a piece of green acrylic, laser etch that design in there, rub in gold paint, and it looks like a gold display on there. And it's so simple. And if you light it, it looks like one of those green displays on, like Fallout, it's got a green display. It'll make it look like that at a fraction of the cost of actually making a display. This is just a piece of acrylic. This piece here, that little metal piece there, that's from the front of the drawer that holds a little tag that says what's in the drawer. That's all that is. These are laser etched pieces of acrylic, mirrored acrylic. I laser etched the back in reverse, getting rid of the mirrored part, then put black spray paint on it and get black letters going through on gold. And these little, they're called bezels. These little bezels, I got them at Michael's or something like that. So, but all this leather is laser cut to get that shape. And so the idea is it's a communication marker. I had somebody say, well, hold on, this is me, because I've done this, I'm doing this thing. Actually, that's the wrong keyboard design because it's not an ASCII. And I said, actually, that's the Ensor keyboard from 1883. So, like, that keyboard design is off of an actual typewriter I have from 1883. And it was really, I admit, it's really cool to be right. We all want to be right. And somebody does this, something. I know something you don't. It's like, and I know even more. And this is from the print, so I was like, again, this guy here, this thing here is a little box to put my technology in. My phone fits in it. This outer box here is actually over 100 years old. You can buy those for 20 bucks. They are starter coils from Model T Fords. They look all steampunk right out of the box. Now they're filled with tar. Literally filled with tar. So you gotta take the box open, get the tar out and all that stuff. But I laser cut all the leather work, all that type of stuff, to get that effect. I even laser cut the wood, I took the whole box apart, take the piece, and I laser cut it. And it just kind of worked out for us. One of my most famous pieces I made, full steampunk Iron Man suit. That's me in there. And this is my favorite picture. You know how you get pictures with celebrities? I get to meet all kinds of cool celebrities because I do stuff for Hollywood. This is my favorite celebrity. You've probably never heard of him. His name's Bob Lee. He's the guy who made it. It's Tony Stark, an alcoholic. He wrote that arc and did it and gave him a personality instead of being just some rich kid with a big metal suit. And he's like, I gotta get a picture with you. And I may have tangled myself a tiny bit. So I was like, oh, God. And I got dinner with him and everything. And I was like, and yes, it sounds like I'm bragging. I'm kind of being a little bit. But actually, this whole suit is laser cut. I told you I can't cut metal, right? I mentioned that. How did I get all that brass to do that? That brass is paper thin. I use something called Kydex. I don't want this stuff. It's great. It's like Hornblende, but not freaky expensive. Yay! And it also comes in big sheets. You can get it in 4-foot by 8-foot sheets if you want it to. When you order Kydex, you can say, hey, can you cut that down for me? Everyone that sells Kydex, you know, like online or online, they'll cut it down to reasonable size. If you have a table that will only accommodate 2-foot by 4-foot, then you can get it cut to maybe 4 pieces that big. You can also get Kydex, nice thin Kydex, easy to work with at Tandy. Tandy Leather will sell you a piece that's about 18 inches by 2 feet.
You can also get it at Regal Plastics locally.
Locally. I don't know, I'm not local, I'm from Pennsylvania.
Yeah, they'll bundle it up and load it in your car for you all nice and neat.
Nice! My people throw it at me. They're like, get lost, you what are you making now? Nothing. Giant robot. But the Kydex is great as an underlayment, because I mean, solid brass would weigh a ton. Brass is actually more dense than steel. So if you're making some bad brass, equivalent volume is going to be really heavy. So you can order, you look up sheet brass sheathing. And what I do is I laser cut the Kydex. Now you can also cut it with a saw, advanced saws and stuff like that. And then I use barge cement, barge, B-A-R-G-E. It's a leather rubber cement. It's used to put soles on shoes, stuff like that, really sturdy. You put it on each piece, you put it on the Kydex, you put it on the metal, slap it on there, and then I run a blade around the edge, trimming off the excess brass. And then I run that over with the sander. And then I do the leather, all the leather work has all the filigree on it. So it looks like I did all this metal work, I did next to no metal work. It fools the eye putting all that metal work in there. That metal work is like putting, you know, gold duct tape under something. But shiny stuff. Put a clear coat on the brass if you can, just Krylon or automotive clear coat. It'll keep you from tarnishing, unless you like that tarnished look. I like the tarnished look. Put on, it'll be nice and shiny, and then people way back there will see you coming and walk like this in your Iron Man suit. But all of that is laser cut there. These little pieces here, you can't quite see, I can't get them close enough. The resolution of this is not going to work. I did mold making. You can get mold making kits from a place called Smooth On. Smooth On. By the way, another cosplay thing that'll change your life is a company called Smooth On. It's out of Pennsylvania. They make all of the mold making materials that Hollywood uses. And they ship them all to Pennsylvania, from Pennsylvania all the way to Hollywood. And people say, no, I buy mine from Reynolds, which was bought out by Smooth On about 10 years ago. Because people like to be contrary and say, no, I know more. And I go, no, I'm old. That means I actually collected a few more experience points. I learned this. But this, you can buy a $30 kit that'll introduce you to mold making. And they have videos online. They're people who work at Simulon, you do this great job. I want this job. If I ever decide I don't want to work for myself, all they do all day is take the materials of Simulon and use them in different ways and do their own art. That's the coolest job. And they got a really cool cafeteria. It's really nice, like fresh veggies. And one of the guys there, they'll talk to you. They'll talk you through your problems with these things. Oh, you're using the wrong pigment. That's why your stuff's not curing. They'll tell you tricks and stuff. And they have videos about all this. I don't work for Smooth on my own. I just think they're great. But you make your first piece. A lot of people will 3D print the same thing over and over again. The 3D print stuff is usually pretty fragile. You know what I mean? You'll grab it. If it's very lightweight, that's good. When you 3D print, then you pump, and also you get those lines in it. You can take that 3D printed piece, you can clean it up, sand it up, so it has no lines. We don't want to do that with 10 of them, do you? No. So you make a mold of that one. And you pour those, and you pop out 10, and they're all cleaned up and perfect. Great for doing weapons that are nice and solid, won't fall apart or break. Also, when you're 3D printing, say you're 3D printing this device. If you're doing it on the lowest settings, fastest settings, all that stuff, this is going to take about 2 hours. And people say, well, you can buy a 3D printer. Well, do it solid if you want. Yeah. 26 hours later, and you don't want, if you're doing a bunch of things, like that has six of those gears on it. They all say Stark Foundry, it's 1889 on it, which was kind of cool. I'm terribly clever. And what happened is I started selling them just the gears. People were going on my site and buying gears from me. But now I just spend half an hour pouring molds on them. Also, you can get a gold like that by putting this gold powder in the mold. And then you mix your resin in, put it in there, pop it out, and it's all done. You don't have to paint it. It's ready to go. I don't know about you, but that excites me. I hate waiting for paint to dry. I'm like, this stuff is like 20 minutes later, it's ready to go.
Where do you get the powder from?
The gold powder?
Yeah.
From Smooth-On, they had it there too. If you tell them what you're doing, you call them, look, I'm making it, and by the way, they know what cosplay is. They're not a bunch of, there's a guy there making an R2 unit. Okay? And there's a new substance called XTC. It's used for getting rid of the lines. It's a liquid, self-leveling liquid, for getting rid of the lines in 3D printing. And he's experimenting with that, making an R2 unit. By the way, they can't sell any of the part they make, and they can't take it home. So, one guy's made this beautiful Tony Stark modern, probably Mark III armor piece using their products, and it's gorgeous. It's flexible. It's shiny, looks like armor, but it doesn't restrict at all. If you tell them what you're working on, they'll direct you to. And they have, like I said, little $30 kits to try these things out. 3D printers. 3D printers are cheap and expensive. They come in two varieties. That's it. most of them that I've seen have about, and this varies a little bit. It's either 6x6x6 or 6x6x8 or 8x8x8, and then they go up to my friend at Bethesda Games, must be freaking nice, has an 18x18x21 build surface. I'm going to his house. He just did, he actually just did one of the helmets from one of the armor suits in Fallout 4 that he helped design, and he just started actually putting it together, printed it out. Nice printer, $3,500 for this printer. Now that sounds like a lot. I remember a printer like that being tens of thousands. They're dropping like this. A cheap, easy to use, right out of the box 3D printer, one better recommended, and there's balances. Someone will say, well, this one doesn't work, this one doesn't. I'm saying all around for a good starter, go to a company called XYZ Printing. The DaVinci printer is an okay for the money. There's another printer that has a better bed, and there's another printer that has a better print head. But put it all together, the DaVinci makes a good series of printers. Their tech service is okay. And mine, honestly, a fan bought it for me. a fan of the TV show said, I love the show, and I was going to buy my husband a 3D printer, and he went out and bought the same 3D printer, so I'm sending this to you. And I was like, thank you. Do I have money? Okay, I don't know your money. Thank you. And then I didn't use it for like a year. I was like, I was afraid I was going to do something wrong with it. Don't do that. Don't be afraid. That's the thing that stops people from using a tool, getting a laser pick. They're afraid of how hard it is. These tools are now designed to come to you. I didn't do any, when I did 3D printing, first it started, it was months before I actually created my own files. There's so much already out there. You can go on Thingiverse.com and just download everyone else. It's like, you're giving this stuff away for free. And because people love, I love to show off my stuff, and they love to show off their stuff too. So half the time, I'm just taking their thing, and another thing is from someone else, and putting it together, and flipping this around here. You can stack these things together, and the 3D printer knows that what it's doing, knows that. They have a 3D printing software. They also have a software called XYZ Maker, and it's the simplest, it's like playing those little blocks as a kid. Take this block, put it on top of that block. You now have two blocks. Take this block, which is kind of round, subtract it from there. Now you have a circle inside of that block. And that's how this works. Then you get used to it after a while, and you can then start doing really cool stuff. But playing with that, it won't hurt you. Human beings have this thing where we hate being wrong. It's a psychological, it's why you'll argue with someone on the internet, you will show them all the charts and everything, and they'll say, that's a conspiracy to tell you that I'm wrong because I know I'm right. There's a psychological thing, you can't stand it. And that's one of the reasons that people hate trying new things or are afraid of trying new things. They don't want to be right, or they don't want to be wrong. And people don't like to learn, they like to know. Especially in modern times, we're so used to knowing. There's so much information on the internet about how to use these things. So, 3D printer is cheap. You can get 3D printers for $300 nowadays. And I'm just like, how many? Okay, I sold a corset. I'm going to go buy another 3D printer. That way I can have two of them running at the same time. And you will occasionally make what we like to call a bird's nest. That's when your 3D printer goes, I'm going to just make stuff all over the place. And it loses its mind. Or a little support thing falls, and it tries to print in the air. And it doesn't know any better, because it's an idiot. There should be a little visual thing, tells you. Because it doesn't do this in the first 10 minutes. No, it does this 5 hours in, and you're like, I can leave it alone for a little while. The optical sensor on there that goes, hey, he's gone. So lasers, same thing, my God. So it's not the material. I'm making another giant robot, actually, which are sculptures of giant robots. Real giant robots are very expensive. So I take a 4 foot, about 2 foot by 4 foot piece of plywood. Do you remember Puzz 3Ds? They were Puzz 3D was a type of puzzle that was stacked three-dimensional things.
Jigsaw puzzle that does it.
Yeah, they're three-dimensional. Well, the cool thing about, 3D printers take a long time to print. Lasers are a little faster, but what you have to do is you just stack things, and you get your shape that way. And I've gotten really good at this. I've made entire weapons, and, Gauss rifles and all of stacked acrylic. By the way, acrylic's really heavy. So I put wherever there is a coverage, I put a hole inside so that that makes it lighter. And I'm like, I start getting really good at it. So 2 foot by 4 foot thing, and it's got to etch the whole piece because it's got to put the three drawings on it. Well, it takes about 8 hours to do a full etch all the way down the table. So I got the full etch done. I'm like, yeah, that's good. Oh, I'm going to do a two pass, which means you're going to do the same thing twice on the cut. So it goes one pass, and I'm like, you know what? I'm really hungry. I've been out here. I'm going to go eat. It'll be fine. I come back, oh my God! Because a piece of the wood had popped up, hit the head of the laser, and the laser works by pulses to the motor. One pulse, two pulse, three pulse, it doesn't know it has stopped. But when it goes the other way and lets the piece down, it now thinks it's over here. So it's cutting the over here part over the part it already cut. And I went out there, and every single little piece had been cut over again by another piece. So remember that 8 hours I waited to have it back, and the other was like 3 hours back? So 11 hours of work, and the whole sheet of plywood just kindling. And I cried. I think that man with tears, but I cried anyway. And my girlfriend's like, she comes out and says, "Did it happen again?" She saw the look on my face. And I'm like, yeah. So technology, all this technology, reliance on it, okay. We shouldn't be relying on technology. You're going to throw your phone away? I'm not. We're going to be relying on this technology. But when it does it good, my God, is it good. When it screws up, it makes up for it like an Olympic sport. And it was, and it cut all the way through it too. It's not like you can flip it over and use the other side. You know, all those little tricks you try to make yourself feel better, none of them. It was made out of pure depression. Throw that away. And I had to start it over. This happened like just before I left on the plane. So I now have that sitting there. And I'm thinking, I got to think about it. I'm going to do it all again. So, other side of it, if I were to pyrograph that same amount, we're talking weeks of work to get the same result. So it beyond first world problems into superhero problems. Oh, I have to spend another whole day cutting that thing that would take weeks. How tragic. Yeah, it's not really tragic. Right? At the time, it felt that way. And then I got this little mantra, it's still better than doing it. It's like every time the elevator takes a long time, I go, it's still better than walking. I remind myself every day. Questions, actually. I love questions because I was talking like this even if nobody's in the room. Hyperactivity is cute when you're 12. When you're my age, you just don't just sit down. So, anyone have questions about technology is used in the
Sorry,
I'm
just
going to pause for a
second. Your shoes.
Where did I get these boots?
Right? Yes.
Okay. These boots are the boots that I'm wearing here. These are by a company called New Rock.
Wow.
Newrock.es. It's a Spanish company. They have great customer service, terrible website. I did not make these boots. I bought them in London. If you go to Camden and you're in London, there's like a New Rock place. Every three stores, there's a New Rock place. I'm 5'11 without them, and I'm 6'4 with them. See those snaps there? I actually put those snaps in there to snap the leg armor for the suit on. Often when you see people doing their cosplay, everything's good, but when they walk, you see flops. You know what I mean? The little flop, because they can't attach it to them. This snaps on there and makes it look like it's all integrated. And it worked out really well. I have had these boots for 10 years. They were $400. That's only 40 bucks a year. I'd pay for that for boots any day. You can get them online. My girlfriend wanted the same boots. She found a pair used for $100. Then she found a pair that has 6 more inches to it. And so she walks in like a baby giraffe, and it looks really cute because she's already long-legged, little blonde there, and she's like, yeah. But it looks really cute. She looks terribly cute. Unfortunately, the creepy thing is, we're both blonde and all that type of stuff, so it looks like I'm walking with my daughter. Which is even creepier because I look a lot more like her dad than her dad does. So, and occasionally people will say, "Your daughter." Oh, I'm just shitting. No one say that. It's already creepy enough. But no, the New Rocks are great. If you watch any science fiction show long enough, you will see some creature or person wearing New Rocks. In Firefly. Jubal Early. The gentleman who, the bounty hunter, you look at his shoes, they're New Rocks. When he's boom, lands on the ship, they're New Rocks. Half the Klingons are wearing New Rocks. All that type of stuff. They're great. Neo in Matrix, all of them are wearing New Rocks. And I'm an old goth from a long time ago. So imagine this for a little bit. I was punk at goth. So imagine this. See this? Shaved, mohawk. 2 foot razor hawk, like this, driving like this. Nobody sits in that seat, nobody touches the hair. Because if they crack it, it's like a cracked piece of fiberglass. It's like, and it's like bad, you can still stick it out. And you got to get the glue and water and eggs whites and stuff to get it out of here. Anyway, did I answer your question?
Yeah, that was
okay. I always have to do that because I tend to ramble. Actually, I think I saw it, and then you can find
that. Yes. I've heard the laser cutting before, but I know with, like, especially with power, when you do the high power, you get the back, back charring on the bottom side from the grate. How do you try to minimize that?
Now, my laser, I have a heavy vacuum pulling the pieces down. Really heavy. I keep my air up, but if you really have a problem with char, like on your front piece or your back piece or whatever, usually the back piece is not as worried about. But you can also put frisket film under there, and the char will go onto the top of the frisket film, and you can peel that off. Frisket film is available from Blick, L-I-C-K, online. It comes in 2 foot by up to like 70 feet, so you can put it on things, and it'll help protect. Make sure you get the lowest tack, because otherwise it will affect your paint job or dye jobs on leather. Also, you want to use, when I use frisket film, it comes in gloss or matte. I use matte, because that way if later on you're using the frisket film, then I'm using it on here. Okay, I airbrush over it. The matte, you kind of absorb it a little bit, keep it from going around. The gloss will let the stuff flow, and it'll flow into parts I don't want. That's why I use that. Was that helpful?
Yes.
You had a question.
How do you usually finish off your 3D prints?
How do I what?
Finish off your 3D prints.
Oh, I take my interns, I sand that. How do I finish off my 3D prints? A couple ways. One of the old school ways is cyanoacrylate, super glue. You can buy super glue in like 8 ounce bottles, bigger bottles. They also make a water thin super glue. The super glue comes in all different types. You get really thick gap filling, but I use water thin stuff and I brush it on very quickly. That will actually make it stronger because it takes all those fibers and locks them in. It'll also fill in your stuff and dry very quickly. Another way to finish it off is what they call a leveling compound. Whatchamacallit? I was describing it earlier. Smooth-On has one called XTC, just the letter X, T, and a C. You mix it up and you put it on, and it fills in all those little gaps. It'll obliterate fine, super fine detail if you're doing stuff that's super fine. So you might want to mask that part off, do the other part, and then go back and fill in with the really fine super glue. And of course, there's sanding, things like that. A friend of mine came up with this idea, and it works for some stuff. He'll take a small piece, and he'll put it in a pot with a little cup of acetone over here, put the lid on it, and turn it on a low heat, and it'll burn off all the high points on things and smooth things out. Stephen Chapman, C-H-A-P-M-A-N, Stephen Chapman, nice older guy and a steampunk maker, so if you put in steampunk, Stephen Chapman, he has a YouTube channel on doing that type of thing, if I remember correctly. But those are the ways that I usually do. And of course, there's old-fashioned sanding. Make sure the wall of your print is thick enough, because you can actually change that. Usually it's just thin, medium, and thick. Some of them have numbers you can do. Learn the metric system, please. Come on, the rest of us are waiting for you to catch up. because most of them are made in another country, and the metric system, you know, X number of millimeters works, is how they do their stuff. By the way, simple metric system. This is so easy, everyone thinks you're so freaking smart. Around 25 millimeters is an inch. So half of that, 12 or 13, half an inch. Half of that, 6 millimeters, quarter inch. Half of that, 3 millimeters, 1/8 inch. All you gotta do is know that, and people will think you're freaking genius. They will, they'll be like, oh wow, how'd you do that? I think a 12-ounce soda can for like 300 milliliters, which is kind of close. By the way, 100 degrees Celsius is really freaking hot. yes, sir?
I have the XYZ printer you said. What's a good operating filament? I know they have proprietary cartridges, but I have a Bluetooth reset.
I just use, because when I print something, I generally make a mold of it. I tend to use their filaments.
Yeah, that's what I was using, man. It's hard to get at times.
I get it on Amazon. And I get it like 2 days later, I have Amazon, you know, Plus or whatever, I've never had a problem. But there's a lot of YouTube videos and stuff on tricking it. I lied to my printer, because it said that the printer, that the filament I got from them was not the right thing.
I just did that.
So here's what I did. And it accepted this lie. I put in the old one that said it was low. I put that in there, and I ran the little bit of filament that was there out of the printer. And I open the lid, and I run the new stuff through and into the injector. So it thinks this chip is working, but I'm using this other thing over here. So I'm lying to it. I've got a key, a fake key in the door. And it printed with the new stuff, and it said, there is so little there. But it kept printing. It didn't stop. It kept going, and it worked. Eventually, it decided, when I decided at one point to change it out, I put that back in there. It said, no, this is good. The one that I said was wrong, no, I was wrong. I was drunk that day. And now the printer works that way. That's the only hack I've ever had to do, because there's someone at XYZ Printing, the one of the reps who saw my TV show and gave me a whole bunch of free stuff. So I'm an insanely stupidly lucky person. I don't know how all this stuff happens to me, because I don't deserve it at all. But that's the only hack I've ever had to do, is lie to it. I guess you could put some other filament in there while sticking that
in there. Basically, it plugs into the chip.
Yep.
But you tell your phone to reset the counter on it.
Oh, nice.
So it tricks the printer to say, hey, it's constantly resetting your new cartridges.
Right, but then you can just run.
Yeah, you buy a thing.
And run any other thing through there. Yeah,
that's the best way for ABS, for heated beds. Maybe use ABS with PLA.
I think I'm using ABS, because my printer only says use ABS.
How do you get it to
I use blue sticks.
Sometimes you get your ball of tear.
I use the blue stick. You can buy those blue sticks, and they come in like an inch diameter one instead of a half inch. So you get a big wide one that goes on. It's a little easier. But yes.
If you take a little bit of ABS and mix it with acetone and brush it on a bed, it sticks sometimes too well.
Okay, you don't have to glue them together to do the friction well.
Do you print it for apps or just directly onto the bed?
I wrap
might help you there as well with reducing some of those vertical disturbances.
Some people put down blue tape and go on top of blue tape too, and it has a bit, because the blue tape has a slightly rougher surface than the glass, so it sticks well to that. And you just have to adjust the bed. It's got those three little adjustments down a little bit. A guy said that the distance should be about the thickness of a business card, from where the head hits to the bed. So you just adjust it down that much, put blue tape on, and occasionally pull up that blue tape. I've seen it. I did not try that. A friend of mine who has an XYZ printer did that at a convention. He was printing stuff. That's, again, there's so much. I mean, every time I put a problem with printer, there's like every different type of guy who goes, I found a way of fixing it. It's pretty interesting. Some of them are just terrible. I super glued that thing right down. It'll never come off.
Oh, wow.
Nice.
And look at that. You're saying did the heat to smooth out the acetone? The heat with the acetone smooth them out?
Yeah.
I know the safer way, since acetone is non-flammable.
Perfect.
The way I do it is Tupperware container, paper towel down two sides and bottom, soak it in acetone, glue and oil piece, close, let it sit for 5 to 2 hours.
Yeah, this guy does it on a hot pad. That way, he's not using only like a gas stove or anything.
Yeah, I don't use heat at all. Fire. I call it a cold pad.
Oh, by the way, I have this thing I always say. I almost utter a thing where it does with tools. Safety third. Because if you want to be perfectly safe, don't use a tool. Stay home. Stay in your bed. You're still going to get hit by a meteor someday. I don't know. But everything like this is inherently dangerous, including dating. Just don't go out if you don't want to do it. It is inherently dangerous. That's why I say safety first. It is a consideration, but if you were just safety first, you wouldn't do anything. when I'm using any power tool or anything, I look at the head. I look at the blade. I look at, when I'm cutting something like this, I'm staring at that blade. You ever hear about the guy who, was staring at a saw blade and stuck his hand in it? No, what did he do? He looked away for a second. I just looked away for a second. That's why I look like this all the time. And that's what happens. When I'm cutting something, big saw over here, and you know how, what happens is that back end hits something. And people go, what? I never do it. I don't care what the cat's doing. I don't care. So someone comes in and goes, Thomas, I go, huh? I stare at the blade. It's freaky. My friends were like, how can you do that? I'm like, no, not. Because you know why? Because I'm 50-some years old, I still have all my fingers. that's the kind of thing right there when you work with your hands. No big gouges. I even have nice nails. So when you're working with these things, be mindful of what they are. You're working with a laser. Most lasers. Mine is stupidly expensive. Mine was a $50,000 laser, but I got someone else to pay for it. But my laser, the laser itself is about the size of a small bread box. It moves left and right, and the table moves in and out. So your distance from the laser to the material is always the same. So my power is just as good here as it is here. Most lasers, the laser is in a container. I'm looking at the laser itself. A container here going that way hits a mirror. Mine has one mirror. There's, hits a mirror, bounces over here to a mirror that goes this way. Hits a mirror, bounces over here, hits a mirror going down. Your distance from the laser, power diminishes as you get. So over here, out of 80 watts, you get 80 watts here, and you're getting 60 here. So you're getting inconsistent cut. Also, when you do a picture, it's a little lighter over here if it's a big picture. And that's why I got the laser I got. And also my nice 2/4 of a ton. It is a dinosaur. And I stand on it, and it doesn't break. And it's pretty bulletproof. Whereas a lot of the ones, basically, it's a sad thing. They say, do you have a Chinese laser? Because they're all made in China. The ones, big boxes, giant box lasers, they tend to be made in China. And that's where a lot of cheap lasers are coming from. They have different problems. They don't have as heavy, and they don't usually have as much of a vacuum holding it down. But people are using magnets and weights. Then you hit the weight, and then that drags your leather, and puts it over here, and starts cutting you. Bad thing. Plenty of ventilation. Lots of ventilation. Have it sucking that thing out. I've got like this gigantic ventilator on there, just pulling air out of there. In the winter, I have to have extra heaters on because it's pulling all the hot air out of my garage. and you see the roof vent has this big area where no snow is around it. And there's a small homeless group up there keeping warm around my roof vent because it's so warm there. And the air conditioning, also out of there, you know, I'm kind of sweating, I'm dying. I've got the air conditioners going strong, but I know I'm not going to suffocate. I'm not going to die from that. Very important. But that vacuum also holds things down, keeps it nice and flat, and you don't have to weigh it down or tape it down. When you're looking at lasers and stuff, these are things you're going to look for. Ventilation, also, there's a small amount of gap called off-gassing when you work with plastics that get hot. So even those 3D printers, make sure there's plenty of air around it, and you're not snorting your into this 3D printer like that. That's probably bad for you somehow. I'm not going to do it now. By the way, if you have cats, and I have 7, 8, 9, I've lost count, do not leave the door open on your 3D printer. Because they'll start batting at that thing. And then when it goes like that and puts glue on them and they run around and they're winking and you're trying to do the thing where you're running in front of them. Everyone owns cats who's going to grind in that nose. They don't like it. You know. And it sounds like a silly thing, but yeah, don't leave the door open. Because you leave it open just so you can see, because the doors might be scratched up or something. Other questions, please? I'm going to let this new lady in.
What is the name of the app that you used to resize a desktop?
The program is CorelDRAW.
Yep.
I'm using CorelDRAW 16. They're up to 18 now. It's a few hundred dollars as opposed to thousands of dollars. You can also go on now. Adobe is all cloud-based now, And you can rent Adobe software. I think the entirety of all Adobe software, if you want to rent, is like $50 a month.
The Creative Cloud. Yeah. If you have an EDU email, it's $20 a month for your first year, and then it goes up to $30 a month.
Now, I'm old-fashioned. I like my stuff on here. I'm on a plane. I'm going to be able to work on it. I don't want to have to use the cloud. Even my phone. I don't back my phone up on the cloud at all.
The suite does download to your computer. You have access to everything should you want to download it. But like I have just like a whole slew of things that is on my computer and I can use it on the plane.
You have to be able to log in and connect to it once a month. Connect to Adobe once a month to say, yeah, you can still use this.
Yeah.
You're still paying.
And Corel's dirt cheap nowadays. I even use Corel 12. Here's what's funny. I use Corel 16. It's really cool. I mean, it does all kinds of cool stuff. It measures for you. It does all the 18. There's one thing I love about the Corel software. If I want to take a piece of artwork and put it in something, it has this thing called Power Clip. You can just take a photograph. And say you have an oval. You draw an oval. You take this photograph, make it so it's roughly slightly bigger than the oval, and you say, power clip that into there, and it just goes boom, it cuts the edges off and does it. So all that artwork fitting perfectly into there takes seconds. Now I know there's a function on, I'm sure there's some function on the Adobe software, but the reason I use CorelDRAW is all my engineering friends use CorelDRAW because it's cheap. Just like us. But the laser is all set up for Corel 12. So I'm using Corel 16, and then I save it as a Corel 12 program or file. Then I open the Corel 12 and I import it to the laser. And that's only because I'm really freaking lazy and have not set up Corel 16 right to go for this. You don't have to do that. You can do it right off of Corel 16 into the laser online. Now my laser is a big behemoth. Some of them are set up to you. You can set up these things to use Adobe Illustrator if you like. But I can even put out Illustrator files with Corel. So, because some people go, well, I only take Illustrator files. If you have to export your work to someone else, you can take your Corel thing, export an Illustrator file, but here it is. And they'll think you have a Mac. Is that enough? Other questions?
So, do you do anything with electronics, like lights on any of your stuff?
Oh, I'm going to tell you, here's the thing. Lights, people love lights on stuff, and it's kind of cool. I'm going to tell you the stupid, simplest thing about lights. So I wrote a kid's book, because I don't like kids. So I wrote this kid's book, and I wrote it, kids like lights on stuff too. How am I going to do this? I don't want them to solder, and I don't want them to just put it together and stuff like that. Then I was looking for lighting, and I went to the automotive department, and I saw all this lighting. It was peel-and-stick lighting. It has a little battery and a switch, so it got to be so easy. It's already wired. I don't have to do anything, but so you got this strip of lights. If you look a little close, it has a little picture of a pair of scissors. That's where you can cut it without hurting it. So if I buy a 12-inch thing, and I only need 8 inches, and I go, oh, snip, and I install it by peeling the back, or usually I replace that glue with a super glue or something like that, stick it in there, and it makes the lighting so much easier. And I'm like, wow, if I want to make my gun go pew, I buy a toy that goes pew, and I tear it apart, and I put that mechanism in there. I know how to do wiring and stuff like that. There's YouTube videos about it. This is so fast and cheap. And there's even, Tandy had them, a few other places have them. They have I think it's got two little buttons, a 9-volt battery and a speaker, and a little microphone. You can record a sound with one button and play the sound back with the other. It's pretty loud. So if I wanted to make a special sound, I go in and I go pew pew pew, and I can press a button and my gun goes pew pew pew. You can also make your gun go, ah, you got me. I mean, you can make it say anything you want. It's really cheap and easy. That's how I kind of do that. I put it in this book because it's kids could then do this. And then it's amazing the level of lights they have and how bright they are. They're all LEDs. My Iron Man suit, at one point, you plug in these two things, and I had these two, quote, pulsers. And I just went like that and pressed, and and there's really super bright lights. I stopped it because everyone said, do the repulsor thing. And all the pictures turned out so washed out because I'm like, and half the audience was like, ah, God, what'd you do? Retina burn. You know, they're just really bright. So I disconnected them. So they can get really bright. Go in there and start playing. And also, the cool thing, you go into the automotive department or the automotive store, look up the lighting, look up interior, goofy, you know, hobby lighting. You can actually press the buttons and see what the lights are going to do before you install them. They're right there. And then eventually they'll say, are you going to buy something? Because you'll be sitting next to me half an hour and go, oh, this one changes color. Oh, this one over here. And they're super bright, less bright. And they even have remotes to change the colors of the lights. I have a little disco ball. It plays the other little disco lights. It's $29. I put it on the end of the staff and boom, and then I start painting something. And the staff glows with this type of light. Was that helpful? It's a super cheap and easy way to do it. You can easily do a day-long course on how to install lighting. Another cool thing is you got that switch. It's only got two wires. Clean those wires off. Cut that switch off. Clean those wires off. Buy, because that's just what's called an instant or a moment switch. As you press it, the moment you're pressing it, it's on. You let it go, it's off. You can get a toggle switch. Put that on there, wrap it around there, put a little bit of tape on there. That way you turn it on, it stays on. In this Iron Man suit, see those lights in the eyes? That's how I did that. There were 3-inch pieces to light the eyes. There's a battery up at the top, there's a switch, a toggle switch on the back of the helmet. On the chest, there's this big arc light look. That is from the automotive store. It's the light that goes around a BMW headlight. Around there to give you these cool light, and it was like $20. And I said, wow, I could spend 3 hours. That would go and give me minimum wage to install this, or I could spend $20 and I'm done. And that's how I did that. That is a little switch down here, 2 9-volt batteries under there. I wish I had something cooler to say about it. It's just that easy. It's going to be embarrassing when you start going, I'm going to light everything. If you can, the cool thing about 12-volt lighting is it'll run from 9 to 18 volts without burning it up. So you take a 9-volt battery or a 2 9-volt batteries if you want to break them. It's more of a range. People think because it's LED, if it's not 12 volt, it won't work. Then you can get actually put more of the bump through them. So go out and light all your stuff.